Hello learners, welcome. I'm Dr. Uma Singh and we shall be discussing and understanding more about principles of management. In the earlier part, we talked about principles of management. Principles are the fundamental truths that guide thought and action, and they help the business in decision making and administering the organization. In part 3, we also talked about the scientific management principles as given by F.W. Taylor. The emphasis of the scientific management principle was on increasing productivity and performance of the workers and on reducing cost. So in this part, we shall be talking about the techniques of scientific management, which are the practices as developed by F.W. Taylor in implementing the scientific management principles. So they refer to the various practices under the techniques of scientific management that help in implementing the principles as we learnt in the part 3 of principles of management. Now these techniques of scientific management as developed by Frederick Winslow Taylor are work study, standardization, functional foremanship and differential piece rate plan. Now let us start understanding one by one what are these four practices as defined under the techniques of scientific management. The first among them is work study. Now as the name suggests, work study. So that means this practice or this technique enables the managers to understand the work, split the work or break down the work in a systematic manner so as to reduce cost and improve upon the efficiency of the workers. Work study is a systematic, objective and critical examination of all the activities being performed in the organization with the ultimate objective of producing the maximum possible quality of production at a reduced cost. Now, work study is further implemented by four studies, namely time study, motion study, fatigue study and method study. So the method of implementing work study is by all these four different types of studies. Now let us understand what these four basic studies are all about. The first among them is time study. So time study means study with respect to a standardized time which is required to accomplish or complete a particular task or activity. So as a result, when you have a standardized time for accomplishing a particular task, it will help in reducing the overall time involved and also developing the best method of doing that particular job. So in a way, again, it is helping the managers to understand what is the standard time and also thereby reducing the overall cost of production and increasing the efficiency of the workers. Now, the main objective of time study are to get the estimated figure of labor cost. So, if you know the standard time of producing a particular product, on that basis, we can calculate that what would be the total labor cost of producing a number of products. Second objective is to determine the number of workers required. So on the basis of the standardized time, we can also calculate the total number of workers that would be required to accomplish a certain task and to decide a suitable incentive plan for the purpose of wage remuneration. So these are the three main objectives of time study. The second study under work study is motion study. So what do motions refer to here? Motions refer to the various movement of men, machines and materials. So it is a study of motions being performed by the workers and the machines while doing a job. Again, to reduce the amount of total time taken and to have a standardized set of the movements that are involved in the men, machine and material so that again the overall efficiency of production increases. So under motion study, the movement of men, machines and materials are observed and analyzed to develop a standardized method of movement of these three aspects. So the main objective of motion study are to eliminate the unnecessary or the unwanted motions, to find the best method of doing a particular job, and of course to increase productivity and reduce the overall cost of production. The third study under work study identified by Taylor was fatigue study. Now, fatigue actually refers to the amount of rest intervals which are required for the people or the employees who are accomplishing a particular task. So, any person cannot on a stretch complete a task allocated. You require rest intervals in between. So, this particular study is a means that provides for a systematic, objective and a critical examination of the causes and consequences of the rest intervals, which are referred to as the fatigue. So, it refers to determine the duration and the frequency of the rest intervals so as to accomplish a particular task that has been allocated to the employees. The main objective of fatigue study are to determine the amount and frequency of the rest required to accomplish a task and to maintain the efficiency level of workers. So, because of the rest that you are giving or because of the fatigue that is involved in accomplishing a task, the efficiency level should be maintained at all the times. But the only idea or the only purpose of fatigue study is to identify these rest intervals, that are at what gaps and at what intervals these rest intervals are required to accomplish the task successfully. The next is method study. So, method means how are you going to accomplish a task. So, in accomplishing the task, we can either use a capital intensive method, which makes use of machinery and equipment, and we can either use a labor intensive method, which involves the use of labor. So, method study is concerned with analyzing and evaluating these methods. So, whether we are going to adopt a capital intensive model or we are going to adopt a labor intensive model of performing the task. And it aims at identifying the most suitable way of performing a particular activity. The main objectives of method study are to minimize the cost of production, to maximize the quality and level of consumer satisfaction, and to select the best method, which will be dependent upon the labor cost, the availability of capital, and the material cost. So, the ultimate objective of method study is to identify that which is the best possible method of producing the commodities. Now, after this, the second technique as given by F.W. Taylor is the standardization technique. Now, standardization refers to the methods of selecting standard materials, machines, and tools for use by workers, and standardization of working condition with respect to lighting, ventilation, etc. So, this technique enables in identifying the standardized methods for your work, for your processes, as well as for the working condition, so that again the efficiency is maintained at all the times and the productivity that is received from the job is the best. So, under this, there are standardized machines and tools, there are standardized methods, and there are standardized working conditions. So, standardized machines and tools, they ensure that they are required quantity and type available to produce a finished goods. So, in producing a particular commodity, you standardize that what kind of machines or what kind of equipments or tools will be required, and not only the type, but you also specify in what quantities they would be required, so that accordingly the calculations and the job can be allocated to the employees. Then the standardized methods or the processes. So, under this, you need to identify that what is the standardized or a uniform mechanism of performing a task, so as to ensure consistency and uniformity in the mechanism processes. And the third is in respect of the standardized working conditions. Under what conditions are the employees going to perform in respect to the temperature, ventilation, lighting, cleanliness and safety. And all these are required for the purpose of improvising your employee efficiency and productivity. Now we move on to the third scientific technique, which is functional foremanship. Now this technique, as identified by F.W. Taylor, is a technique wherein a worker is supervised by several experts or several specialist foremen. Now, Taylor was of the understanding that it is essential that the workers must be supervised by a team of experts, which will help not only in improving efficiency, but also overall reducing the cost and better productivity for the organization. So, it is based on the principle of specialization and utilization of the expertise of various experts. So, according to him, it is necessary that these experts help and enable the workers to perform better. And he suggested that the division of work of the factory or the production floor is divided into two departments. One is a planning department and the other is a production department. So, according to him, you require experts or specialists under planning division and similarly for the production division. Now, under planning division, the experts that he identified was route clerk, instruction card clerk, time and cost clerk, and shop disciplinarian. Similarly, under the production experts or specialist, he identified the role of four major experts: gang boss, speed boss, repair boss, and inspector. Now, let us further move and understand that what is the role of these eight specialists or experts that have been identified under functional foremanship. Now, foreman under the planning department, the first among them is a route clerk. So, as the name suggests, route means he would be responsible for the process of production and identifying the route through which the raw material will pass. So, if supposing there is a certain production procedure before the final product is manufactured, so what would be the stages or what would be the processes involved through which the raw material passes from the first stage to the last stage. Second is the instruction card clerk, who would be responsible for laying down the instructions for the workers who have to follow them to perform their job. So, while performing the job, the workers have to have clear instructions that how the work has to be performed so that there are no accidents, there are no defaults. So, this had to be laid down by the expert of instruction card clerk. The third is time and cost clerk. So, he would be the one who sets the timetable for doing a specific job and also determine that what would be the standardized labor cost and the material cost for each process or for each product. So, here the role of the time and cost clerk is to determine a standardized time under which the job has to be accomplished, and apart from that also the standardized cost in terms of labor cost and material cost, which are there for the purpose of accomplishing a process or an operation or a product. The last foreman under planning department is a shop disciplinarian. Now, for any job to be done in a good manner, it is necessary to maintain discipline. So, the role of a shop disciplinarian is that of maintaining discipline and obedience in the factory management. So, this was the role of these four experts under the planning division. Now we move on to the experts under the production department. So first identified is a gang boss. A gang boss is a one who arranges for workers, machines, tools, materials, equipments required for the job. So basically he brings in together at the right time and at the right place so that the job does not stop, it keeps on pursuing and they are all arranged in a proper manner. Second is a speed boss. Now it is essential that when the process is in operation, there should not be any interruptions. The speed has to be maintained. So the role or the responsibility of the speed boss is to maintain the speed at the desired mode so that unnecessary delays or other aspects can be identified and can be removed. So the basic purpose of speed boss expert was to ensure the speed at which the products or the processes are being used or maintained and identify the causes, if any, of the delay or unnecessary interruptions in the process of mechanisms. The third is the repair boss. So his role is that of maintaining the machine, tools and equipments with the ultimate objective that the work or the processes does not get delayed or stopped. So his role or responsibility is related to cleaning, greasing, oiling. So in whole, he is the one who would be maintaining all your machines, tools, equipments in the proper order and in the best possible mechanism so that the work does not stop and there are no interruptions when the mechanism is in process or is in operation. And the fourth expert identified under the production department is the inspector. So his role was to be sure that the productivity or the final output that is produced agrees to the standards quality test. So he is the one who ensures that the products are being manufactured as per the standards established. So in a way, Taylor identified the role of all these eight different experts or foremen, which are essential under both the planning division as well as under the production department to be absolutely sure about the products, about the processes and about the cost of mechanism and operation. The last technique as identified by Taylor is in terms of differential piece rate plan. And as the name suggests, this is a technique which relates to the wage remuneration that is given to the workers. Now, wages constitute a very important portion of the employees or for the employees and the laborers. They are the ones who help the employees and the laborers to feel motivated and also inculcates a sense of loyalty and belongingness to the organization. So Taylor advocated the adoption of a differential wage rate system with the intention to motivate the employees. And he was of the framework that the wages to be paid for the work done by the employees or the laborers should not be on the basis of time, but should be on the basis of the products that are manufactured. So accordingly, he differentiated two wage systems. One was a high wage rate and the other was a low wage rate. Now, according to these two different mechanisms, the whole idea was those workers who are able to produce the standard number of units within a fixed duration are to be paid at a higher wage rate, and those workers who are not able to produce the standard number of units within the time specified should be given a lower wage rate. For example, let us assume that the standard number of units that are being manufactured or that are to be manufactured, let's say within 1 hour, are 20. So if a worker is producing 20 or more than 20 number of units, then he should be paid at a higher wage rate because he is manufacturing more than the standard number of units. And if a worker is producing less than the standard number of unit, which is 20 in our case, then he should be paid at a lower wage rate. So as a result of this, the workers would always be motivated and it will help them in boosting up their morale to produce more in order to earn more. So high wage rate is given for the purpose of producing standard number of units or more than that. And a lower wage rate is granted to the workers who are not able to produce standardized number of units. So that was the whole idea about the differential piece rate mechanism. So under these four techniques, we have understood that the process of implementing the scientific management principles is through these techniques, with the whole objective and intention of improving the efficiency and reducing the overall cost of production. So I'm sure you must have understood the concept well, and you will be able to understand it better when you now go and read the chapter. Thank you very much.